afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the family, thank you so much for being here today. My name is Robin, this is my husband Phil, and we'll be doing this for you today. And so we'd like to invite you to sing along with us on Amazing Grace.
Trust in you, command that he be carried safely home to heaven and come to enjoy your eternal reward. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you all to be seated now as I read from the Bible. To me, all you who labor and are burdened, and For my yoke is easy and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Why don't you be seated? I never got to meet Bob in this life. So the family shared some beautiful things about him, and I'll leave those shares to them. Other than that, he would have been such a neat person to meet. That's just what I got from him. Such a gentle giant, you could say. A gentle giant. And somebody, not only who had big muscles, who you wouldn't want to have tackled in football, but it seems to me he had a very big heart. I mean, he accepted 5 new children into his home all of a sudden. Your heart has to be so big to be able to do that. Generous, making room. You know, it's a huge honor for priests to be with people in the most significant moments in life. Whether baptisms, births, kids, or marriages, but also when times are hardest. Struggles and suffering and even in death. And so I just got to be called to the bedside of Bob as a priest and to give him prayers that would commend his soul to God on the last moments. And then we had to just got to talk about this beautiful man. So we have this man. I just want to offer you that we also have so much more than what our eyes can even see. Because behind him is a force, an energy, a power, even deeper than that. Persons holding him in existence. Even before we could lay eyes on Bob, somebody was already looking at him with love. The Bible says that God knits us together in our mother's wombs. And so even before anyone could see Bob, God was at work, creating. So important that he was going to do everything in receive the light of Christ, scatter the darkness now, and lead him over the waters of death, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Our brother Bob was nourished at the table of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Many friends and families have gone, members of the families of Bob have gone before, and await him in the kingdom. Grant them too an everlasting home with your Son, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for all those who are struggling with long-term illness and chronic disease, that God would give them comfort, grace, and healing. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the family and friends of Bob who are grieving his loss, that you would give them comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of your Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now I invite us all to pray in the words that Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Let y'all be seated now to have some words from you.
Thank you all for coming today. My dad had a lifelong friend, Bill McCloskey, and Bill couldn't be here today. He was out of work more than his family, but he sent some words that he wanted me to read. So, in the words of Bill McCloskey, Bob and I have known each other since we were 5 years old. He was a big kid even then. I never fooled around with him because he was the toughest kid in class. A big, red-headed Irish kid, and he was my friend from then on. Every day we played some kind of sports together with Richie, Jackie, and Tom in particular. Then we began playing football in high school. Bob was up front, clearing the way for me to run through holes he created. After high school, I went off to Vanderbilt in Nashville, and he went to play at Xavier in Cincinnati. When I broke my leg, my scholarship was not really there. I was talking to Bob about it, and he talked to Chuck Clausen, our old Pitcairn High School coach, and they decided that the Xavier coach should take a look at me, and the rest is history. Bob and I played together again. I was able to go to college, which I never would have been able to afford. So I owe him so much. Bobby Bennett, William Sankey, Mike Hassett, and I were all roommates and an old Army barracks. Bob and I shared a room. Bob and I shared everything, in particular a car. But we didn't fool with the same money. We all graduated together, except Bobby Bennett. He had a few credits to make. I was an only child, and Bob was a brother to me. We kept in touch throughout the years. We saw each other when we could. He spent 2 years in the military while I made it a career. A special time was when Carolyn and I first got together, and we stayed with Bob and Donna for a few days. She loved them right away. How do you describe a friendship like we had? I'm in a wheelchair now, with a broken hip that won't heal. Bob was in a wheelchair in his last few years. Thanks to Jenny and Carolyn, we were able to talk to one another via Zoom. How special that was. We still told the same jokes and called each other teasing names and remembered the old days. I have lost a brother. He is a part of me. I love him and will miss having him here on Earth so much.
We are made up of our accomplishments, of the things we do and say, and the way we hold ourselves. We are made up of how we see people and what we do with our time. We play different roles in different people's lives, and thus exist in an abundance of perspectives spread out across the minds of our loved ones. What I can tell you about my grandfather, Rob Marnay, will sound different than what his lifelong best friend, Bill McCloskey, might be able to tell you. And even so, within this there are continuities, common threads that help us capture the spirit of Bob Marnay, so that it may live on in each of us. And one of those common threads that I just know that each of us in this audience has a story on is the way that my grandfather loved and how he chose to protect those loved ones so fiercely. My grandfather was a protector. Just as Bill noted, he was big, and even at age 5, his classmates knew not to mess with him. This week, I've heard countless stories on how my grandfather was called upon to stand up to bullies when they were picking on the local guy, on how he put himself in the middle during altercations arising from playing on some of the first integrated football teams, on how he made sure that those around him were not only safe, but taken care of. I've learned so much about my grandfather this week from others' perspectives, from going through boxes and boxes of photos and his well-preserved archive of letter correspondence alongside our newly minted family historian, Nancy. One letter we found was in regards to his working days at 3M when he was the manager of a team. Each member of his team was apparently going through a difficult time in their personal life, but my grandfather refused to fire any of them, despite calls for this by upper management. Instead, as the letter writer notes, quote, at great personal sacrifice, he worked with these personnel, counseled them, and within a year they all slowly returned to full functioning efficiency. The final results proved him right as to the importance of human values and insisting in people in an unforgiving corporate environment. End quote. This was a theme throughout his life. My grandfather looked out for his team at 3M, despite an environment that actively discouraged it. He stood up for his friend Bill when the head coaches decided he should lose his football scholarship. And he lovingly expanded his family by 5 kids when tragedy struck his sister's family. And throughout all of these decisions, amidst all of life's celebrations and challenges, he was always a steady, consistent force that just kept showing up. He stepped in as a father and a father figure for many people, always there for counseling major life decisions, for reassurance, and of course, to throw the ball around. Importantly, he never ever stopped telling and showing the love of his life, Donna, how much he cared for her, even in the 12 years after her death. What a truly excellent example of love and marriage this man has given to us all. From all of these perspectives, my grandfather was a protector, someone who cared and loved for others so other side of him. But I also had a different perspective. From my perspective, he was this big, happy man. Although as I grew taller, he became, of course, less big. To me, he was made up of woodworking and cooked foods, turkey sandwiches, of never saying no when my sister and I wanted one more cookie, and of tons of football stories. He was a fierce proponent of education and an avid reader. In fact, when my sister and I were younger, we were never teasingly asked what our boyfriends were named or if we liked anyone. Instead, he asked about our grades, about what we wanted to study in college. When I got older, he always listened intently to my ramblings about different classes. He lent me his books from his vast library, and we talked about them after I had read them. His support and interest in my studies is a big reason that today, still, I'm in school. My grandfather's encouragement of educational pursuits extended most importantly to my grandmother. In particular, in 1976, when they were living in Sylvania, Ohio, when he supported Donna's wishes to attend bookkeeping certification courses. She got her certification and eventually became the office manager and bookkeeper at Dr. Klinoff's dental office in Stillwater. Bob was over the moon to see Donna excel and find so much meaning in work outside of the house. To Donna, Bob also played this role that he played in so many other people's lives, the steady protector. But she also got an adventurous and spontaneous side of my grandfather. I remember listening to stories of their motorcycling days where they'd take off with the saddlebags packed and on a plan in the world, stopping off at all of the Dairy Queens along the way. In protecting and caring for others so deeply, Bob made it so that we got to realize our best selves, to succeed and strive, despite sometimes existing in environments that sought to limit us. You all made up Bob's life, and as such, carry pieces and stories of him in you. From these different perspectives, from understanding who Bob Monahan was to each of us, we might be able to pool our memories of him and capture his spirits today and in the years to come. Today we gather not just to celebrate Bob's life, but also to decide how he will live on in each of us. Grandpa spent his life telling stories about all of us. Now it's our turn to carry on his memory by telling stories about him.
Thank you.
A joyful sign.